Hi guys, welcome to New India Junction, our first ever episode of Bharat Ki Laxmi. We have a very special guest today. Let's get started. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here.
I'm Sadhvi Jaya Bharti. I am a sannyasi, a disciple of Sri Ashutosh Maharaji.
Now, if you could tell, I have been in prison reform a little bit before, so I know all about it. But if you could tell our audience, what exactly, why is this needed? Why is organization like this so important?
See, the question that you put is absolutely in context, because a lot of people focus on education, health, gender justice, environment, but rarely somebody thinks about prisons or the prisoners. Let me put it in this way, that nobody dies in the jail. As many people who go inside the jail would be coming back.
Come back out. Yeah.
So the question is with us, how would we like them to return? As they went, hardened criminals or reformed, better, productive citizens of the society. So that's what the question my guru put to me, that in case the people there are, my guru looks at it, that he says that these people, they have a lot of potential. He calls them peace breakers, and he says that peace breakers can be transformed into peacemakers. So they have the potential, they have the energy. It depends on us, do we have the right means, or do we really work to channelize that into the right direction? So this organization becomes, or this initiative becomes, very important, because we need to work on the core of the people. Where the thought of committing a crime or ending in conflict with the law sprouts. So we work there, so that we just nip the thing in the bud, or nip the bud there itself. And so that we could transform their thought process in the right direction, give them the right opportunity, right techniques to introspect and correct themselves.
Now, before we get into the statistics of it, because I'd love to know, you must have seen so many cases like this. Mm-hmm. You were an athlete before all of this. So
yeah.
Now, the title of this series is Bharat Ki Laxmi, mm-hmm. and it focuses on just the wonderful things that you do for mm-hmm. the country. And obviously, this is very, very important, and this is, I would say, very understated, because we don't hear about this type of work in the media so much. Mm-hmm. But how did you get into it, from sprinting to this?
Yes, I remember. Most of the life I remember was on the field,
yeah.
and on the track. So running across, and I think I've come a long way. And it came when I was almost at the peak of my performance, and I came across this.
How old were you then?
I was 20 years old.
Okay.
So when I was 20 years old, I came across this organization, and I was in my hometown, Dehradun.
And when you say organization, you mean Antar Kranti, right?
Divijyoti.
Okay,
yeah.
Sorry.
So when I Divijyoti Jagriti Sansthan, I came in touch with around 2000, and it was then when I was back home, Dehradun, I had a back injury, and I came in touch with the organization, and they said, why don't you, because being a sports person, it's very difficult for you to sit back and rest. So I was restless while resting.
I was just going
to
say, you know, an injury makes you very
restless.
And discover
yeah.
new things about the world.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
But that injury was a sort of a boon to me, because I came in touch with the organization, and they were establishing the Sarv Siksha Abhiyan that was started then in the slums. So we had a couple of very dense slums in Dehradun. And I went to a Raipur slum, I remember, and I found a girl with 40% burns, and somebody had tied some bandages on her, and she had whole maggots in her body. By the time we discovered, it was already 8 days past, she got burned. And there was foul smell in the hutment, because the pus was literally flowing out of her body. Mm. So I called the organization who had, you know, took my voluntary services, Divijyoti Jagriti Sansthan, and I went. I called somebody, said, sir, I found this girl, I don't know what to do. He said, I'm reaching the head of the branch there. Mm-hmm. And he said, you reach there in the civil hospital, I'll be reaching back. I took that girl, and I remember 3 clinical mugs of maggots came out of her body. And I was literally in an utter state of shock. All the social...
Imagine,
yeah. And all the social service by that time has vanished from my head. Mm. I couldn't really remember that. I thought I had done something really very drastic, because if something happens to this girl, because doctors have said that she would die and there's so much infection.
So she was still alive.
She was still alive, yes. And she couldn't speak. She could barely speak few words, and doctors said she won't survive. But since you're bringing it from an organization, and we are a government hospital, we're not denying the entry, but we won't guarantee anything. And it took us, we were 7 people taking care of her. In the midnight, I called Guruji and I said, doctors are saying she would die. Have I done something wrong that the blame would come on me or on the organization? I was in an utter state of panic, and he was in the highest state of calm. And he just spoke few words. He said, Jaya, your job is to serve her, doctor's job is to treat her. Mm-hmm. Leave the job of saving to the savior. That's not your job. Right. Just do your service. And he hung up the phone.
It's a great answer.
And I just, thereafter, we seven people just took care of that girl. And it was on the 13th day that she was discharged from the hospital.
Oh, wow.
Hale and hearty. And that was the turning point of my life. That if I could
amazing.
Consistently under his guidance work like this, if I can make a difference to one life, I can make difference to so many life for rest of my life. So it was then that I sprinted towards sannyas.
You sprinted.
So, okay. And it took me 5 years to convince my Guruji, because he said, you're doing well, go get married and all sort of things. He was not very keen. But then he said, if I like, I'm persisting and I'm really resolved to take this, right? So he said, remember, it's a razor's edge. Yeah. Now your life becomes a public life. You've got to serve others. It's none of your thing. It's never about you. It's all about others. So if you're ready to tread it, welcome. So it was then in 2005, I joined as a sannyasi. And I never looked back. It was all serving other people. And the best part was when I was given the service, or the seva as we call, for the prison sector. Because there is a set of people who cannot come to you. It is to you, it is to them that you've got to reach.
So that leads me into my next question. Let's look at some statistics. Can you give us some statistics about people in prisons and the rehabilitation procedure? Because a lot of people just are not aware of, you know, they are aware that people go into prisons, but I don't even think that conscious awareness is that, okay, if they're going in, they're definitely coming out, then what? A lot of people are not aware of it. So can you explain that to me a little bit?
These, if you look at the statistics, the situation that takes shape is very grim. So there are almost 1400 prisons in India.
Right.
And every prison is overcrowded. If you talk of Tihar, it is doing double the occupancy. It's been constructed, it's been made to house around 6,000 prisoners, and there are 12,000 plus in it.
Jeez.
So how do people
just... more than double occupancy.
Yes.
Okay.
So, and 75% of people in jails are below the poverty line. So poor cannot manage to stay out.
70%?
75%.
Okay.
They're below the poverty line. And if you look at these people, we can very easily go and say that they have committed crimes. Yes, we can. But if you look at the conditions that they are born in, that they have been brought up in, you would be very fairly understanding that they never got the opportunity to learn right things in life.
Can you give me a... have you seen an example? I'm sure you've seen many examples of that. But can you give me an example of maybe somebody who has gone into prison just not seeing or not being exposed to what he or she can do?
I'll tell you, there's a jail where only boys under the age of 21 years are, you know, lodged. And if you see, a lot of the boys are from the resettlement colonies or slums. And there are certain communities where, you know, stealing, robbing is a very accepted profession. I won't like to name those communities.
Right.
So, you know, I remember Ashutosh Maharaji once told me that, you know, guide them, help them to figure out and discover their talents, what they are good at, what are their interests. We did a profiling, we did a, you know, a skill and interest mapping. And then we provided them with a lot of services. So it was for us surprising that they were so good at singing and they were so good at painting. Because, you know, the basis of the reforms work, because we can say reforms and rehabilitation, and when we talk of rehabilitation, a lot of people go about, you know, provisioning or in providing a lot of things, support, money, clothes or whatever. But for us, for Devajyoti Jagriti Sansthan, the reforms is about correction of the mindset. It is the foundation. And once the mindset is corrected, once it is a reformed mindset, anything that you build upon it is stable. So when we do the correction of mindset, we do it through spiritual tools, we do it through Brahmagyan. We have centers where they meditate, where they get the, we take Brahmagyan and they meditate. And there we found, you know, there was a one small guy, he was 7-8 years old, who came into the...
8 years old and in prison?
No, he was 8 years old when he came to Delhi.
Okay.
And he was working as like, you know, small odd jobs at shops and right. So by the time he was 14, 15 or something, he his friend went to snatch money from somebody and he was just along with the friend. And he ended up in the juvenile jail. Thereafter, he grew up there and he shifted into Tihar. I'll tell you, he was not even fifth pass when he came to us. So then we got him admitted into the NIOS and then National Institute of Open Schooling, and then IGNU, these facilities are in the jail. And I'm so delighted to tell you that guy, he got released when he had cleared his 12th standard from the jail.
Oh wow.
And then he came directly to our center. He worked with us as an inventory assistant. He used to maintain inventory where the products made by prisoners were stored. And he did his bachelor's in social work while he was working with us.
Wow.
And today he is an inventory manager with a lead company.
Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah. So
that's actually amazing.
Yes. And they still connect. We are a family, you know, wherever they are, they keep telling us. So he learned skills with us. He educated himself. He grew up and now he's working, he's got a family, he's got a wife, he's got two children. So now he's doing good
work.
How
old is he now?
I think 30 now. He must be 30,
Gosh,
30 plus.
It's a long journey for him, but
yes,
a productive one from where he's been and where he's headed to now in the future.
Right. And he is no more in that bad character list of the police, or people don't jump on him because they see how he's living his life, how is he performing in life.
Do you see a lot of the prisoners that you work with, are they, because now when they've lived a certain lifestyle, even as children, if they've been in juvenile prison for certain number of years, then they get transferred to a prison like Tihar, which is a very intense prison with more than double occupancy, so the conditions are probably horrific over there. Do you see, I mean, there's a certain mindset, you said that mindset is the basis, but it's the most difficult thing to change and to kind of put in a way that is, you know, as you said, once it's stable, then you can build on that. But to get to that level of stability, do you feel that a lot of prisoners that you work with, maybe not just the juveniles, but the other prisoners as well who are adults, do you find that are they willing to change their mindset? Is it a difficult process? Can you describe that to us?
Not immediately. Few are very willing, few are very resistant. So, you know, it takes time. So you have to start interacting with them. You don't have to judge them while you talk to them. And you've got to look at their human side. No human being who's surviving on earth, you know, lacks a human side. Everybody does. So does the prisoners. So if I, you know, so we, when we work with them, it's gradually that we build the faith. And spirituality, the knowledge of your own spirit, is so potent that it leaves no person without affecting him positively.
Right.
So we have to guide them that you have the power within. It's not, you're not just a composition of body and mind. You are beyond that. You have a very, you know, ethereal person, your own personality. You have an eternal self. So once they know that, okay, they have another side of their existence, so it is then they are encouraged to discover themselves. So through Brahmagyan, through, because we have centers, self-development centers inside the jails where these people come, we talk to them, they get counseling, they get group interactions, and we do guide them through spiritual means. So it, you know, inculcates in them a sense of introspection, and when they meditate, so the knowledge of spirit is more powerful than the mere information in the mind.
Right.
So that knowledge purifies the mind, you know, refines their thought process, the knowledge of
Brahman. Plus they're occupied. I mean, when they, you said that he was getting
I remember there was a guy, he's still working with us.
Okay.
And he's one of the, he was very vociferous. He used to get so angry with little things and used to fight with everybody at the workplace or, you know, working unit inside a jail. And, you know, it used to be very hard. And even the jail authorities used to give us the toughest cases that they could handle elsewhere. Okay, send them to the Divyajyoti ward. So because they'll be able to handle. So it used to take us a while. But today, what he used to do is, in the morning, he used to get up early, take a bath, and he used to sit in meditation, say around 4 or 5 in the morning. He used to get up, then go to the workshop, come back, work all the day. and then sit in the meditation in the evening. And when we took an interview of his in one of the time, he said, the best thing that I found is that I have no time to sit idle. So, you know, when you engage, so we have a program called positive engagement. When you engage them consistently in positive activities, the transformation is bound to come. Right. It is upon us, what sort of environment do we provide to them so that they could discover the better self of theirs. So that's how we do with them. And today the same guy is heading our Bhavana store. He looks after all the inventory and sourcing.
Amazing.
So you know,
and heading means a leadership position,
right? So. Yes. And I'll tell you, maximum people with whom we've been very successful working and, you know, taking our program from success to success are these release prisoners. Mm-hmm. We have discovered they are the most dependable people.
Okay.
You could leave so much with them, whether it's the stock, which is expensive or anything, but we've never found a complaint with them.
It's interesting, and I'm sorry to interrupt you, but it's interesting to note that, you know, you said they're the most reliable people, but
yeah,
when you come out of a prison,
mm-hmm,
you have a lot of mental sort of trauma.
Yeah.
You have post-traumatic stress disorder.
Yeah.
A lot of the prisoners have to adjust back into just normal life.
Mm-hmm.
Do you find that do you help with that, or do they naturally come out of it, or do you have
rehabilitative? We manage it while they are in prisons only.
Okay.
Because our intervention does not start when they get released.
Okay.
Our intervention starts when they are inside the jail.
Hmm.
So Divyajyoti's volunteers, they go to prison Monday to Friday every day.
Okay.
So they go to the jails. So we have centers over there. Prisoners stay there in the centers from 9 to 5.
Okay.
So if they have their dates, their mulaqat, their hearings in the court, they leave. Otherwise, if they're in the jail, they're at the center. So the rapport that we build with them and the time that we get in with them, we use that time in, you know, making that changes happen that we need them. We prepare them for release, post-release, so that when you're released from the jail,
right,
what sort of outlook should you have? How much should you expect from the society? How much should you take on your own self? And
right,
in case you need something, then we are there to help you.
Which is a positive thought in itself, because
yeah,
the mindset automatically changes to,
right,
when I get out,
yes,
this is what I'm going to do, which is very positive to a prisoner.
Right.
And that is what a lot of countries, other countries, lack, that,
yeah,
you know, prisoners think it's one of the biggest things that weighs down on them is, I'm never going to get out.
They just get desperate as to when we are going to get, because everybody,
yeah,
is going to get out, you know.
Yeah.
Even authorities cannot afford to keep housing them with the kind,
right,
of infrastructure we have. And I wish that India needs to get out of making more prisons, but look at alternative sentencing and correction methods of people who are involved in very petty crimes. Because we have dealt with even hardened criminals. There were people who were gangsters. There were people who were murderers, who were hired killers. And today, if you see those people, they are the ones who are running probably charity schools, they,
yeah,
are running charity clinics, and they are helping people, they volunteer with us. So it is the transformation and change from within that can transform a hardened criminal into a very productive and very productive citizen for the society. Everybody has in itself, so we have to use the right tools. And I feel that the more you take somebody inside, because everything doesn't work on merely information. I cannot ask somebody to change. But the moment that person gets to know the inner strength, the knowledge of the spirit, Brahmagyan, the person changes. You don't have to force. I remember once I was talking to Ashutosh Maharaji and I said, what exactly changes them after they are initiated into Brahmagyan? So he said, Brahmagyan awakens in you the vital vigilance. So vital is, that is the living inside you. So you have a living vigilance inside you. Your own self has to be vigilant of your thoughts and of your actions. The moment a person becomes vigilant about what he is thinking and what she is doing, I don't need to monitor them anymore. And that's what brings the change in them. And that's, it's the same knowledge that empowers them and that actually builds them, builds an outlook in them that I have to live a better life. I don't have to get into engaged into these, you know, lower attributes.
Have you seen any failed cases? I don't want to say failed cases, but unsuccessful cases or more difficult cases. And what do you do in those instances?
I'm yet to come across one.
Oh wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, but I can say semi-successful.
Okay.
Yeah, because there are people who are still afflicted by, you know, their some personality attributes like anger or probably getting into quarrels or something, because initial issues with when you work inside the jail is quarrels. You know, they quarrel so much,
yeah.
Get into fights on petty issues. There's another world where they really work to create their own dominance inside the jail.
Right.
So you have to get them out of that mindset and that friction. Mm-hmm. And once they're out of it, I don't think, because the path I have taken while when I was a youngster and I was pursuing my business studies and my sports thing, there's some sort of an awakening within that took me towards it. And it's the same awakening. It's not that I got some different knowledge or and the prisoners got some other knowledge. It's the same knowledge. If people like me who've been educated and groomed to look like from a, you know, profit maximization theory, if I can change into a person to serve better, I think anybody can change.
Yeah,
so it is it is the technique that we apply to change people. It's not what people are. If Angulimala Daku could have changed in the Buddhist era, so why not these people?
Yeah, it's a great way to put it. Can you give me some statistics on how many people Antar Kranti has helped and how many people you've helped?
Yeah. See, it's not always easy to put them in figures because jail population is a moving population,
right?
So, you know, only, you know, every day at least lakhs of people come out and lakh of people go inside the jails back.
Right.
So, but you know, on average, if I look at one rehabilitation center, so if I have 40, so average 100, 120 people come into each center every day.
Okay.
So they get benefited in one way or the other. But if I look at statistics, because we started way back in 1995,
yeah.
So it's beyond two decades now.
Yeah. Right? Congratulations.
Thank you. So we have, not exaggerating, we've touched more than 2.5 lakh lives.
That's amazing.
Yeah, and the best part I feel is, you know, when we started working on creating very good products, because we found many, many people poor. So there's a, you know, there's a saying in Hindi, Bhuke bhajan na hot gopala,
yeah.
Right? So if you don't have money, if you don't have resources to sustain, there is, at times there are so poor people in jail that they can't afford to buy a cup of tea at odd hours from the jail canteen.
Right.
So how do you, you know, provide them? So we started creating, you know, very beautiful products. So it was a personal care range and the aroma range. So a lot of, you know, volunteers dropped in. They designed the products. So now the From Prisons of India is an Antar Kranti brand.
Yeah.
We call it Antar Kranti Naturals and Antar Kranti Aroma. And if you just, it's a Diwali season, you go around and you look, search online, you go to Mall of India, you go to Delhi Heart, you go to, you know, Blind Diwali Mela, Blind Relief Associations.
Yeah.
You would find, and these products are appreciated for the packaging, for the quality and the cause behind it.
Yeah.
And, you know, they have empowered the program. I think prisoners have empowered the program themselves.
Yeah.
So the quality products that they make, it generates revenue and resources that we need to, you know, pull through this program.
Right.
So their hard work and just a bit of assistance from us has made this program a completely, completely self-sustainable program.
You know, and what the most important thing that I see, New India Junction focuses a lot on youth.
Yeah.
And we are an incredibly young country right now, demographically.
Right.
And when you're talking about juveniles, and even when you're talking about adults that are getting out, it's not just they are getting out with a positive mindset. They're getting out also as productive citizens. Which, even if they hadn't gone into prison, if they had just led the lifestyle and been in the conditions that they were in, even if they hadn't gone to prison, they would most likely not have been contributing to the country as much as they are now, which is the most important thing.
They say that. Sometimes they say it's good that I went to jail, at least I discovered myself. However, nobody wishes to. I give crazy invitations, let's go to jail, I'll show you. So, but the thing is, yes, and working in this area, it's been a discovery for myself. It really teaches you how to work and operate in the most you know, opposed situations, very difficult situations, very difficult people, people from different states, different languages, different beliefs, different, everything is different.
Yeah.
And you've got to deal with them. So it actually helps you discover your own strength. Mm. Yes, you can do it. And then obviously it gives you a sense of self-actualization once yeah. you've done it.
Yeah.
So I really thank the organization that gave me the platform. I thank my guru for giving me the insight and the spiritual strength. And it was he who established this in 1995. And then, you know, I've learned from him how to stay in the back seat and let other people drive it. He has
so
never,
important. Actually.
Yes. Yeah. So, but it's been quite a discovery. And I really wish one thing that people, this is an area which is most neglected. These are the people who are considered as a condemned lot, but they are the people with a lot of potential.
Yeah.
They are really daring people, and something extraordinary can be done with these daring people.
Yeah.
And the only thing is you've got to give them the right perspective, right knowledge, and right direction, a bit of support, and they'll do it.
How, now coming back to you,
mm-hmm.
how do you plan on, what is the next step for you? This work is so important.
Mm-hmm.
How do you plan on taking it forward? What's next for you?
Yes, it was given to me as a task only by the founder and the head of the organization, Sri Ashutosh Maharaji, that India doesn't have even one post-release rehab home.
Mm.
It doesn't have. So whatever set up infrastructure...
To date, there's not even one.
Not even one.
Okay.
So, you know, which is a quite systematic or formally, which is called as prisoner rehabilitation section. So when they come out, people come out of 14 years, 20 years in jail, and in that time, the world has changed for them.
Yeah.
They've been at one point and the world has moved ahead 20 years, 14
exactly.
years. So it's very difficult for them and catch up with the pace. So we are planning to build a post-release rehab home.
Okay.
And we wish that we do it soon. We are garnering resources. We're trying to catch hold of it, where these people can, you know, safely land and they can be further launched
yeah.
into the society. So they need, where at times they need mental health support, at times they need a lot of emotional support.
Yeah.
Their children need education support. Now there's a woman who got released, but the husband didn't get released. She has three children. Mm. The work of the family is ruined. So she's working with us. We are providing education support to her children. We've given her a job. So she's earning, and you know, at least she's relaxed to that part.
Right.
But now we are doing it on a very, you know, ad hoc basis with whatever infrastructure setup we have.
Right.
So for us, the next task is to at least have one, you know, a very good established facility for post-release rehabilitation, especially for women.
That's incredible. And how can people help? How can our audience help? How can they find you? How can they find the organization? If you could give us any way that,
yeah,
because I'm
just,
sure a lot of
you
people...
You could just Google Antakranti, and you can just contact Antakranti or buy Antakranti products. If you could just, you want, this is 100% volunteer organization.
Yeah.
We only hire and pay to the prisoners. Rest, I'm a volunteer. Everybody who is providing, it is 100% volunteer run organization. So you could best support us by volunteering.
Okay.
You have any sort of skills that you would like to share with us, you would like to promote their products, you want to come and engage your time with them, talk to them, teach them something, any support that you want to give them, you are very welcome. So it's just, you could write to info@antakranti.org,
okay,
and we'll get back to you. You could just log on, you just Google Antakranti, you'll find it all over the Google.
Okay.
And there is a contact information, and you can, the best is if you want to support them by being where you are. A lot of companies have come forward, they hold our stalls over there, their employees buy. There are a few companies who have given us monthly contribution from whatever their employees feel like. So all the resources, because you know, at times they're only single parent,
yeah,
and one parent is in the jail. So the risk is on, even on the children who are left behind.
Right.
Nothing remains for them but just to get in conflict with the law, do something, you know, which is, can be termed illegal or which can be termed as an offense. So we have to make sure that those children don't drop out of their education, they have food, they have a shelter on their home. So all this money is utilized for them. So anybody who would like to support, they are most welcome, because Antakranti and all our activities have been surviving only on the generous support of volunteers.
That's awesome. And I'm sure, and I hope that this interview brings you a lot more volunteers.
Looking forward.
I think I will definitely come and help you out.
Thank you so much.
And is there anything else? Now we are going to see an assembly line that you're going to guide us through.
We have two units. We have two units. One is the units where male members, the men who are released from the jail, they manufacture products. Few products are manufactured inside the jail. And here is a unit we've specially, you know, dedicated to women who assemble, pack, label all the products that are made by prisoners.
Okay, great. So let's have a look at it.
Please.
Okay, so now this is just outside where we had our interview. So where are we going right now?
We are going to the workplace where women prisoners work.
Okay.
So we don't, you know, we really want to work in deep in the community. So this is the area, they live nearby, it's easy for them to reach here.
Okay.
And still look after their families while they work.
So their commute is better than mine.
Walk. Yeah. So just walk down here. And we make it, we try to make it that, you know, they don't only work exclusively like women from prisons, but, you know, we engage women from, you know, ordinary women who have not been into jail, so that these women prisoners who've released, they get an opportunity to gel into the normal, in the normal society, in the mainstream.
In a very natural,
manner. And it's been a very, you know, successful experiment, because we haven't found any reaction from the other side of the society. They've been accepted.
That's awesome.
And, you know, it has even sensitized people that even these people who are released from jails, they need, they also need an opportunity to start their life again.
Oh, that's awesome. I can't wait to meet them. So
this is our small unit.
Okay.
Where these women feel like home and feel like work.
It feels like home, actually. It's
yes.
A very peaceful feeling over here.
They manage it entirely. We really don't make it really supervise or do something.
Okay. And here they are.
Yeah, they are assembling a wooden gift set there.
Okay.
Yes.